Naturally, if I work in that building, yes, sir.
Back up, man.
Come on, Mr. President.
No, they're taking me in because of the fact that I live in Missouri. I'm just a patsy.
August 4th, 1964. Two American ships report that they are being attacked by North Vietnamese military units in the Gulf of Tonkin off the coast of Vietnam. President Lyndon Baines Johnson immediately declares it an unprovoked attack and orders retaliatory strikes against North Vietnam, asking Congress to authorize action in Southeast Asia. Believing Johnson's claims, legislators act quickly, giving him carte blanche to use military forces in Vietnam. However, documents declassified from the National Security Agency in 2005 confirm that the attack never took place. The Tonkin Gulf Resolution was signed by President Johnson on August 10, 1964. This decree was the doorway through which the United States officially walked into Vietnam.
Reznov.
You will answer our questions. Do you understand?
Who the hell are you?
That's not important. What's important is who you are. What's your name?
Fuck you!
Where were you born?
Kiss my ass!
Your name is Alex Mason. You were born in Fairbanks, Alaska. In 1961, you served in a CIA assassination team known as Operation 40. Is that correct? Is that correct?
Yes.
Where's the broadcast station?
I don't know what you're talking about.
The numbers, Mason. What do they mean?
Where I don't know anything about any numbers.
What about Dragovich? Do you remember him? Give us what we want, we'll guarantee your safety. Let's start at the beginning. Cuba, 1961, the Bay of Pigs. We know you were there.
No.
Do not fuck with me, Mason. I know when you're lying. 61, Bay of Pigs. What happened?
We all got killed.
There's no use lying, Mason. We know you went in with Woods and Bowman.
Woods? Bowman?
Dragovich. Do you remember Dragovich?
Castro. We went in to kill Castro.
The police are gonna be here soon. Let's make this quick.
Woods, it's been a while.
Not enough, Carlos. You know Bowman, right?
Carlos.
This is Mason.
What's up, Carlos?
So you got what we need?
He will be in here. The plantation. My old plantation. Our attack on the airfield should distract them enough to get you inside.
What about the evac?
You will have transport waiting for you. Just be there.
Excellent. We got company.
Saque los papeles. Ahora. Sal de aquí, puta capitalista.
Oye, ¿de dónde tú eres?
I said, where are you from?
Just be cool, Woods.
Why are you talking to you?
All right.
Everything is ready.
Gear up, boys.
Say good work, Carlos.
No problem. My men will dispose of the bodies.
Última advertencia.
Occupants leaving their vehicles armed with shotguns.
Bowman, Carlos, lay down covering fire. We fight our way through the streets. Mason, on me.
Let's go.
Clear them out. Move up the street. Bullman, take the right. Munoz getting up on me. There's a compound.
You're dead. We killed you.
No. You killed a double. You think we didn't know of your plan?
We always know.
Do with him what you wish, General. He's my gift to you, in honor of our new relationship. Just make sure that he suffers.
He will know suffering beyond his darkest fears. I have plans for you, American.
Oh, he did. Dragovich sure did. Set up. They knew we were coming. That bastard Dragovich.
The Russian.
Yeah. He was behind everything.
Where did Dragovich take you?
To Russia. A labor camp. Oh, a hellhole called Vakuta. Oh my god.
What did they do to you, Mason?
What didn't they do?
Castro just kill you? Why did he give you to Dragovich?
Because Castro and Dragovich were working together.
Yeah, you were a gift.
Yeah. Right.
Where did Dragovich take you?
Vakuta. He had to fight. Just to survive.
What happened in Vakuta, Mason?
I was on my own. Almost a year.
Fake Mason! What did they do to you?
I've given up hope of ever getting out. But Victor Reznov found a way.
You will break, America!
Victor Reznov!
My friend.
You hit like a child!
Вы только через силу понимаете! Собаки!
Hey, сволочь!
Эй, всегда ты ее знал!
Dragovich.
You should have been my finest agent. It would all been so much simpler.
Dragovich!
It is simple. I'm gonna kill you.
Try to fuck with my mind. You fail.
You don't know anything.
Try to turn me against my own. I can make you kill my own president!
Right?
Come on, Mason! Mason, this way! Go, go, go! This place is falling apart!
Mason. You did it, Mason.
You did what I could not.
Mason! It is over. We won.
For now.
What's so incredible, too, about this picture, St. John, is other than the person purported to be your father, who truly looks like a tramp, he had dirty clothes and a ruffled shirt and everything else, the two people in front of him have clean shoes, clean pants. I mean, they look just like preppies.
Yeah. In fact, they do look like they're well-washed.
Now, your father, of course, sends you this tape. We're going to play this in just a moment. And I've got to ask you this. Do you, first of all, believe his story? I mean, he's named LBJ. He's named a fellow by the name of Cordmire, who was with the CIA.
Mm-hmm.
What if your father was just lying to protect himself, to protect all of you, and to protect those who truly might have been involved in the JFK assassination?
Well, okay, a couple of points here. I don't think he would have... lied because there, at that point there was no pressure from any other angle that would have caused him to create a story. Second of all, if he were interested in creating or fabricating a story about the JFK assassination, he certainly would not have implicated some of his closest associates in the Cuban exile community and in the CIA, and certainly would have not implicated, by inference, the American government itself. He would have, much more than likely fabricated a story involving a Soviet plot, painting a picture that Lee Harvey Oswald was a Soviet sympathizer, that was a Soviet agent, or something along those lines. He was still an agency man, my father was, and although he had been, he'd been bitter about his treatment by the American government, the Nixon White House, he was still at heart a patriot and would have not had said anything to sully the reputation of the CIA or the American government.
Do you believe your father could have been, if he's one of these tramps in this picture, could have been involved in the assassination?
Well, the photograph of the tramp certainly looks, you know, very, very much like my father. By my father's own testimony to me, by his own admittance to me, he was a bench warmer, those are his words, in the what he called the big event, which was the running code name for the assassination to kill President Kennedy.
Sure. So he knew it was coming down. Right?
Well, according to what he told me, he knew that it was coming down. He had attended a couple of meetings at safe houses in Miami, Florida, and apparently the plot was to have taken place in Miami.
All right. Now, we're going to listen to a tape. You're going to hear some names mentioned. This is the voice of E. Howard Hunt in a tape that he sent to his son, St. John Hunt. It's a longer version of the tape. What you're hearing is an edited, shorter version.
I heard from Frank that LBJ had designated Cord Meyer Jr. to undertake a larger organization while keeping it totally secret. Cord Meyer himself was a rather favored member of the Eastern aristocracy. He was a graduate of Yale University and had joined the Marine Corps during the war and lost an eye in the Pacific fighting. I think that LBJ settled on Meyer as an opportunist, Perrin like himself, a Perrin, and a man who had very little left to him in life ever since JFK had taken Cord's wife as one of his mistresses. I would suggest that Cord Meyer welcomed the approach from LBJ, who was, after all, only the vice president at that time. And, of course, could not number Cord Meyer among JFK's admirers. Quite the contrary. As for Dave Phillips, I knew him pretty well at one time. He worked for me during the Guatemala project. He had made himself useful to the agency in Santiago, Chile, where he was an American businessman. In any case, his actions, whatever they were, came to the attention of the Santiago station chief. And when his resume became known to people in the Western Hemisphere Division, he was brought in to work on the Guatemalan operations. Sturges and Morales and people of that ilk stayed in apartment houses during preparations for the big event. Their addresses were very subject to change, so that where a fellow like Morales had been one day, you're not necessarily associated with that same address the following day. In short, it was a very mobile experience. Let me point out at this point that if I had wanted to fictionalize what went on in Miami and elsewhere during the run-up for the big event, I would have done so. But I don't want any unreality to tinge this particular story, or the information, I should say. I was a bench warmer on it, and I had a reputation for honesty. I think it's essential to refocus on what this information that I've been providing you, and you alone, by the way, consists of. What is important in the story is that we've backtracked the chain of command up through Cord Meyer and laying the doings at the doorstep of LBJ. He, in my opinion, had an almost maniacal urge to become president. He regarded JFK as he was, in fact, an obstacle to achieving that. He could have waited for JFK to finish out his term and then undoubtedly a second term. So that would have put the LBJ at the head of a long list of people who were waiting for some change in the executive branch.
You know, I've already passed this story on to Glenn Beck at CNN, Headline News, St. John, and I think this story will probably become world news in a much bigger way than it already has very shortly. An amazing story, absolutely, which may either open up the door or at least close the door to, I think, one of America's darkest hours.
Yeah, it is truly amazing. And from my point of view, as my father's son, I have the deepest love and the fondest memories of my father, the greatest respect for him, and I think that at the end of his life he was certainly brave enough to pass this information on to me. We had quite a few conversations about this. And it was at his behest that I wait until he passed away, that I should reveal this.